defending national champion Villanova. College basketball tonight on FS1 and the Fox Sports app.
I got a little Ohio State Villanova parlay. Get my weekend off to a good start.
More betting information. Time for Say What? Rams head coach Sean McVay gets a lot of attention for being a young offensive guru. However, he has a lot of help on the defensive side of the ball in Wade Phillips. Yesterday, Phillips talked about why he decided to join McVay's coaching staff. Say what?
Well, it was mostly my son, Wes, who worked with him, you know, with the Redskins. So Wes told me all about him. I'd met him before, but Wes told me all about him and all the great things about him. Wes had already said he thought he was going to be a great head coach, and he has great command of the room and all those things. And so it was really from Wes, you know. Now, Wes is a young offensive coach that knows Sean McVay, just if anybody's looking for another head coach.
The family business.
Family. Bum Phillips to Wade. West tight ends coach in Washington.
Wade's one of my favorite coaches to ever be on the staff. I mean, he's a hilarious, great teacher of football. Gets along with different personalities. There is no millennial, no age gap between him and any generation. And if you ever fly on a flight with him, man, he's the worst. He's like, when the plane takes off, he counts down from 10 every flight. 10, 9, 8. Then you get to 1, 0. Oh, we've cheated life again. He's like, 90% of plane crashes happen the first 10 seconds. Like, well, thanks.
See, you know, I've talked about my partners before you, my television or my radio partners before you. I once did a week of radio shows with Wade Phillips, him as my partner.
Yeah, it got canceled.
Got canceled. You're unbelievable.
Time for your AT&T wake-up call. Big win for the Lakers last night. They took down the Thunder in OT behind 32 points at a Kyle Kuzma. Nick, you surprised the Lakers pulled this one out?
Hell yeah, I'm surprised they pulled this out. They were getting whooped in the first quarter. Then they played very well there throughout the second through fourth quarters. But then I thought they blew it at the end of regulation when Lonzo fouled Russ to allow him to force overtime. Then they dominated overtime. That is an outstanding road win for the Lakers with no LeBron and no Rondo.
That's like finding money on the side of the road. Man, what to expect? We were counting this one already as a loss. We were counting up what position would they be in when LeBron came back. We were hoping for a round 10. Big win for them.
The long-awaited Boogie Nights finally upon us. See what I did there? Boogie Cousins expected to make his Warriors debut against the Clippers. It'll be his first game since rupturing his Achilles playing for the Pelicans nearly a year ago. CC, you're the injury expert here. How long do you think it'll take Cousins to get back to full strength?
Oh, it won't take him that long. You've seen him in the workouts being able to shoot his jump shot. And when you're playing with Golden State, I mean, how hard do you have to play? I think the first 10 games are very, very important just as far as style. They've never had a center like him who can score the basketball. So what type of pace will they play at? How will they get him involved? And if you're on the opposing team, I would attack him on the offensive end. I would make him play defense. I would make him get down in the stance and move laterally. Typically, there's still some stiffness in that Achilles. That's what I would try to attack.
Teams are going to try to pick and roll Boogie to death and see how well he can move. But I thought the point you made about him earlier in the week, which is when Steph came back from his groin injury, they made a concerted effort.
Yes.
Let's get Steph back on track that he was pre-injury. When Klay was in a slump, they made a concerted effort to get him involved. Well, if you expect him to do something similar with Boogie, make him feel at home.
Yeah, they want to see that ball go through the bucket. They're going to get him a couple good looks.
All right, back to the NFL now. Marcus Peters made some headlines after the Saints-Rams matchup, saying, quote, he and Sean Payton will have a nice bowl of gumbo together. The teams matched up again. Both Peters and Payton said their gumbo-related tiff is now behind them. Nick, who's going to have the last laugh in this one?
Well, listen, I think the Saints should win the game, which would give Payton the last laugh. But it should be noted, Peters and Tlaib both got hurt early in the year. Tlaib went on the shelf. Peters played through it. Those first 10 weeks when he's playing through the injury, he played really poorly. Since he's been healthy from week 10 to now, he's allowing a passer rating of around 64. Like, he looks like the old Marcus Peters again. So they didn't get a healthy Marcus Peters in the first matchup. They're getting one in this matchup.
Yeah, and they're going to have Tlaib. So both of them on the field, I believe, gives that secondary of the Rams a little bit of an edge. Saints can't be one-dimensional. They can't throw it to Michael Thomas 20 times. They're going to have to be able to get Teddy Ginn and others involved. I believe this is one of the great matchups that we're going to see this weekend. Saints wide receivers versus Rams secondary.
That touchdown right there is the last touchdown pass Marcus Peters has allowed this season.
Yeah, but that interview won't be his last spicy one.
Finally, the Saints' high-powered offense facing off against the Rams' defense. And Ndamukong Suh said the Rams are focused on stopping the Saints' elite backfield of Alvin Kamara and Mark Ingram. See, whose backfield is more important on Sunday, the Saints or the Rams?
Well, Nick brings up a point as far as Jared Goff in this quarterback, the four quarterbacks, even though I believe he's got good throwing talent and he's got a very good arm and great release and great timing, he's got the least talent of all the four quarterbacks. So you can't run that offense without their running game. You can't run that without Todd Gurley and the force for which they try to get him running downhill. On the other side, Drew Brees, he's been more effective at this point in his career the last 2 years. Why? Because they run the ball. Both of these offenses are set up that their running games are vitally important. I just believe with the injury to Sheldon Rankin, that offensive line of the Rams, it becomes more important to try to wear down the Saints. When you come into an offensive huddle, there's two different types of verbiage. There's one verbiage, which is very, very long for a pass play. Typically, the running plays are very, very easy. Let's go scat right, 32, blast. You don't need a whole bunch of communication to be able to do that. It's just a matter of trying to move guys off and get onto your assignment. So it's important that the Rams are able to quiet down that crowd. So I'll have to go to the lean of the Rams' backfield because of the style for which they're trying to play.
And that's in regards to when the running backs are actually running the ball. But when the running backs are split out, Justin, talking about these matchups all week, and I want you to expand on this, so I'll cede my time to you for a moment. The Kamara out of the backfield as a receiver, I think you believe could be the biggest key to this entire football game. What Kamara does catching the ball, whether it's out of the slot, whether it's coming out of the backfield running a wheel route, that could be the Saints' biggest edge in this entire matchup.
Just imagine if Odell Beckham, if they lined him up in the backfield behind the tackle, quarterbacks in shotgun. Imagine Antonio Brown lined up in the shotgun next to the quarterback, and he's running the route on a safety and or a linebacker. The weakest part of the Rams defense are their linebackers that they play. And to me, this is the mismatch of the weekend. Can you get Kamara in space on these linebackers and or on these safeties? I don't believe there's an answer. I believe on certain plays, they're going to bracket Michael Thomas and they're going to bracket Alvin Kamara coming out of the backfield. That's the only way they're going to be able to stop him and slow him down.
Which is why having Ted Ginn back is so important, because you bracket both those guys. Ted Ginn, whomever on him, is going to have no help. And Ted Ginn, till he's 50 years old, is going to be able to run a straight line as fast just about anybody in the world. I do believe Gurley has to be great. He's the best player on the Rams offense. And I want it. C.J. Anderson, he's 120, 170, 140 as far as his yardage production over the last 3 weeks. Can he, behind that excellent Rams offensive line and an injured Saints front, can he be effective in wearing them down? But Alvin, what Kamara and Gurley can do as catchers of the football out of the backfield, that could be the best weapon each of these offenses
has. It should be noted, the Saints have not given up a 100-yard rusher since week number 17 of 2017.
Right.
All right, so one of the best in the league as far as keeping backs under 100.
All right, let's get back and talk about the Patriots now. It's become almost an annual ritual to wonder if this is the last iteration of Brady.